Next on Unsolved Mysteries. A young woman is abducted from a popular college bar and makes a daring escape from her captor. Police suspect that a man who drank a protein shake laced with insecticide was poisoned by his own wife. Small town politics turns deadly when a powerful lawyer is murdered. The evidence points to the deputy police chief. And three people researching their family history seem to be guided by long-lost ancestors communicating from beyond the grave. Our team is standing by. Perhaps someone is watching who can help solve one of these cases, and maybe it's you. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Join us. Mishawaka, Indiana.
You, my friend, will be buying the drinks.
So what do you a local to? Hangout for college students.
Yeah? Yeah.
A young woman, who we'll call Lori, has come here with a friend for a night out.
Oh, yeah. The girl.
We did our usual, setting up the pool table, all making little jokes where I'll bet you that I'll beat you, two best out of three.
Can I get a beer, please?
Lori briefly left her friend and went to the bar to order a drink. And that's when she noticed that she was being watched. Uncomfortable, she walked away. As she moved through the bar, Lori paused near an exit door. The next thing she knew, she was being dragged from the bar.
I was taken to a car that was no more than 6 feet from that final door, and it was two men pushing me into this car. And quicker than I could snap my finger, we were backing up.
Lori was held down by one man in the back seat while another drove. 20 minutes into the ride, the men began to argue in Spanish. The driver then pulled the car over and got out.
I believe that the man in the front had decided not to carry on from this point.
Get over here.
The other man pulled Lori into the front seat and drove to a nearby apartment. Lori fought back with anything that she could grab. But she only enraged her assailant more.
Dragged me into a bedroom, and that is where he was able to overpower me, and he violently raped me there.
What began as a simple evening out turned into a night of terror. But Lori is a fighter. After a daring escape from her attackers, she bravely chose to come forward and tell her story, hoping that it would help bring them to justice.
After the assault, I got this fire inside of me, no more. So I just took that power and I brought my knees up and kicked him off of me. And I ran through into the living room. I just thought, get out.
Lori tried to get to the door, but she was overpowered.
And he threw me up against this wall by my neck. I could hear the bones in there crunching, and I could feel it. The pain was overwhelming. I knew he's killing me. And I said, no, I have more to life than this. And as hard as I could, I brought that knee up into his gut. And I just ran for that back kitchen door.
back off!
And I can hear him coming, and he's screaming, you know, and it's getting louder, meaning he is right on my tail. And I ran, and I screamed. And I could hear him coming through that gate. There was a dumpster at the end of this alley, and I ran real quick around behind that dumpster, and I squatted. And I sat there and I listened, and I could hear the gravel coming. I know he was out there looking for me. So I tried to just hold my breath, and you're so hysterical. That was the hardest thing, to control my breathing, because I didn't want him to hear me.
Biding her time, Lori waited several minutes before she ran from her hiding place and found a payphone.
How long ago did this happen?
10 minutes ago. He grabbed me and pulled me out of there.
Yes,
I came and I screamed. Nobody came.
Ma'am? They know where you are now. They're going to be sending help now.
The police arrived within minutes.
What a relief that was. And I could just feel my body just drained of exhaustion from the fear.
I ran this way.
Lori retraced her escape route, leading authorities back to the apartment.
She was going through the most traumatic time in her life, but yet she was able to give us the location of the residence where it took place. She was able to give us a description of her attacker. It was important that she remembered where this attack took place because we could link the suspect to the residence. We were then able to identify a person named Rufino Castaneda as a potential suspect in this case. He had a history of choking and assaulting at least one other woman.
If you recognize any of these people.
Lori identified Castaneda from a photo lineup and police moved in to arrest him. But he had quit his job and vanished. Investigators suspect Castaneda's partner in the abduction was a relative. However, there is not enough evidence to make an arrest. Lori continues to be haunted by the harrowing experience.
You might be out in public and there might be a smell that takes you right back to it. And it's just like you're right back there living it. I remember every single thing. I don't remember bits and pieces. I remember everything, right down to the smell of that man, to the sweat that was on my body, all of that. This man needs to get off the streets before he does this again, because I don't believe the next woman will make it. And nor do I believe that I was the first.
Update. Rufino Castaneda has been captured in Mexico. He was brought back to the United States to face the charges stemming from the rape and abduction. He was later convicted and sent to prison. Next, a man almost dies after drinking a poisoned protein shake, and his wife is the one who made it for him. Redwood City, California. On a March afternoon, paramedics rush to a local toy store. In the employee's lunchroom, they find 23-year-old Gilbert Ortiz, drenched in sweat and suffering from severe cramps.
Gilbert, did you drink or eat something?
A shake.
What's in a shake, Gilbert?
Gilbert tells the medics that he became ill after drinking a protein shake commonly used by bodybuilders to help them bulk up.
Gilbert, where did you get the shake from?
A friend.
A friend?
Yeah.
His room wet.
Gilbert begins to slip in and out of consciousness. Paramedics contact Gilbert's wife and rush him to a nearby hospital.
Is that the shake right there?
Yes, sir.
Doctors are puzzled by Gilbert's condition. They examine the plastic sports bottle that contained the shake and set it aside so that the contents can be tested later. Within moments, Gilbert's wife, Elizabeth, arrives. doctors hope that she can provide some reason for Gilbert's mysterious illness.
Have you ever seen that bottle?
No, never. I've never seen it. No.
You know what we're
Later thinking. That afternoon, hospital officials contact other members of Gilbert's family.
I just thought it was going to be over right away. And, you know, a few hours later, he was going to be able to go home.
By that evening, Gilbert has developed pneumonia and his kidneys are failing. Then, cardiac arrest sends him into a coma. Sometime that afternoon, the sports bottle belonging to Gilbert Ortiz vanished from the emergency room. It was the first of several bizarre occurrences which led investigators to believe that Gilbert had been poisoned by someone close to him, someone he thought he could trust. Gilbert Ortiz and Elizabeth Fuentes married shortly after the birth of their son, Jonathan. Gilbert took a job at a local toy store. He and Elizabeth often fought over money, so it was a happy day when Gilbert was promoted. But less than a week later, he was in the hospital fighting for his life. In the waiting room, Elizabeth received a strange phone call, which seemed to upset her.
Okay, bye.
She got nervous when she came back from that phone call. I don't know why, I don't know what they told her.
Well, I'm gonna go home and I think I should check on Jonathan.
And so she decided that she was gonna go see Jonathan and she was gonna go to Gilbert's work and she was gonna go see if she could find anything because Gilbert wasn't getting any better.
He's got Jonathan, that man has Jonathan!
Elizabeth, what's going on? And about 2 hours later, she came back. She was hysterical. And she kept saying, somebody has Jonathan, this guy has Jonathan, somebody has Jonathan.
What happened?
That man outside has Jonathan. He said he was gonna hurt Jonathan.
Wait, he has Jonathan outside?
The man said he was gonna kidnap him.
And so I was like, wait, your mom has Jonathan.
Kidnap Jonathan.
I'm gonna call your mom.
And I went and I called her mom. You know, I asked her, you know, is Jonathan there? And then she's all like, yeah, he's right here. I'm like, why? I'm like, because Elizabeth just said that some guy had him.
While Brenda was on the phone, Elizabeth told a confusing story. She said that she'd been approached by a small boy in the hospital parking lot who took her to a man in a parked car who was wearing a mask.
Gilbert had drank the wrong stuff.
What?
The stuff in the bag.
He said Gilbert drank the stuff in the
bag. Inside the paper bag was a bottle of liquid insecticide.
I'm calling the police.
Know. No, don't call the police. He said if you call the police, he was going to hurt Jonathan.
I'm calling the police.
The ICU nurse made two phone calls, one to the National Poison Control Center and the other to the Redwood City Police. Elizabeth was later questioned about the masked man who she said gave her the insecticide.
So tell me about the little boy that ran after you. Well, when I was in my car,
The first hour of the interview, she maintained the story that she had given the officers and the nurses at the scene. And she told me that she thought it was definitely a strange story, but it was the truth.
Your story doesn't make sense.
I still couldn't believe what she was telling me. And so my partner and I started to jam her by telling her certain things to see how she would react.
There was a witness in the parking lot. He didn't see a man with a mask and he didn't see a little boy. All he saw was you. Okay, I made that part up.
Why?
Because the doctor, you know, he said that whatever Gilbert drank was in the house, okay? And so I went, he asked me if I had any insecticides, and I looked, I searched in the house, and that's when I found the bottle. I was scared. I didn't know if Gilbert had done this to himself on purpose.
She told me that maybe he was trying to hurt himself, and so I asked her, you mean you think he was trying to take his own life? And she said, yeah, maybe he was depressed, and I didn't want him to get in trouble.
Elizabeth, would you be willing to take a lie detector test? Look, I have a job interview, okay? So I gotta go.
Elizabeth never returned to the police station. The next day, Detective Anderson called her, but Elizabeth refused to come in.
Would you talk to your lawyer about it, please, and give me a call back?
The only person who could tell police where the shake had come from was Gilbert, and he was still in a coma. 11 days later, Gilbert regained consciousness and confirmed that it was Elizabeth who had given him the protein shake.
Working for some people.
Gilbert explained that Elizabeth had told him about a co-worker's son, who had bulked up by drinking protein shakes.
You know, I lift weights and all, but I could never get big. And that's the kind of guy she likes.
Gilbert said Elizabeth met him in the toy store parking lot.
Hey, hi.
The shake was already mixed in the plastic sports bottle.
I didn't open it until I got inside. It looked like a real shake. I mean, like a chocolate shake. That's what it looked like. So I kind of tried it, right? And then when I tried it, it sort of like burned my throat a little bit. And I said, maybe that's the way it's supposed to taste. I don't know. And I kept drinking and drinking it, but I didn't touch the food at all. I almost finished the bottle. And then I started feeling really hot. And my throat's really, really burning. And I was all shaky. And then I felt like getting sick.
Investigators obtained a search warrant to see if they could trace the insecticide or the plastic bottle to Elizabeth. But at the Ortiz apartment, they discovered that Gilbert's wife had vanished, along with the couple's two-year-old son, Jonathan.
Then that's when it hit me. She did it then. I said, where's the baby? He's gone. That's the main part that really got me. Her, you know, fine, she's gone, but the kid, you know, I was too attached to the kid. I still am.
Update. After several years on the run, Elizabeth Ortiz has been captured. The Redwood City police received a call from the FBI with the news that Ortiz had been detained in Mexico. She had started a new life under the assumed name Rosa Negrete. But Jonathan was not with her. Ortiz was brought to Redwood City for trial. Assuming that Ortiz would arrange for her son to visit her, detectives had this computer-generated composite of Jonathan posted at the jail.
I received a phone call from a deputy telling me that they had a little boy at the jail, and the little boy was a dead ringer for the composite picture that we had.
Jonathan had been brought to the jail by a relative. The following day, Gilbert was finally able to see the son that he had been missing for 8 years.
I was 2 years old when he disappeared, and when I got him back, he was 10. As soon as I saw him, he just came and hugged me. That's all it took. One big hug. I cannot explain what that felt like. It's just too much of an emotion, I guess.
Gilbert and Jonathan began the long process of getting to know one another as father and son. Elizabeth Fuentes Ortiz was convicted of attempted murder and was sentenced to 25 years to life. She served her time and has been released. Next, a lawyer is shot at point blank range and someone has tampered with the evidence. East Chicago, Indiana. For years, everyday life in this blue-collar community was controlled by the local political machine. One of the city's most powerful dealmakers was an attorney named Jay Given. He was a master fundraiser and a clever behind-the-scenes operator who traded on favors to create strong political alliances.
My father was intimately familiar with the politicians, the people in power, knew all the skeletons in their closet, and that makes you very powerful in a town like this.
Given had served as city attorney and helped elect Bob Pastrick as mayor of East Chicago. But within 2 years, they had a falling out.
On a number of issues, my father and Mr. Pastrick split. Obviously, my father's attentions were starting to turn towards electing somebody else other than Bob Pastrick as mayor.
The Elks Club in East Chicago was the scene of a Las Vegas-themed fundraiser for County Commissioner N. Addison Spann. The city's best-known black politician, Spann was considering a run for mayor against Bob Pastrick.
Okay. Well, gee, goodness.
How are you this evening? Well, I'm delighted to be here.
Given's appearance at the fundraiser was seen by many as an attempt to solidify East Chicago's white and black voters against the growing political strength of Hispanic Americans, a group known to be supporting Bob Pastrick for re-election. Given had worked the room for 2 hours. After saying his goodbyes, he headed out of the club, but never made it through the front door. Jay Given was shot once in the back of the head at point-blank range. The murder occurred just a few yards from over 400 people, and yet no eyewitnesses have ever come forward, and the police have yet to charge a suspect. On the night of the murder, detectives found the shell casing in the entryway of the club and a spent .45 caliber bullet in the street.
I was astonished at the remarkable condition that this evidence was in. Projectile come through the frontal part of his forehead, went through the glass doors, hit the building across the street, brick building, and bounced back into the street. It was in perfect condition, with the exception of the nose of the projectile.
Inspector DiCera marked the bullet and locked it in his desk drawer rather than check it into the evidence vault.
I've done it with other evidence. My partner has done it with other evidence. I just wanted the other teams to look at what we had as far as evidence. And I said, this is unbelievable.
4 days later, Inspector DiCera was shocked to discover the evidence had been tampered with. Someone had apparently hoped to prevent investigators from matching the bullet to a gun.
On the shell casing, a hole was punched through the primer. The projectile, someone had taken a sharp instrument and tried to cut the lens in grooves where you couldn't identify it.
The only people with access to the evidence drawer worked in the police department. It looked like an inside job. DiCera sent the bullet and shell casing to the FBI for analysis. Despite the damage, they could identify the murder weapon as a rare handgun called a Detonics 1911-style Combat Master. The shell casing was eventually linked to one of only 58 Detonics with a specially modified ejecting mechanism. One of those guns was traced back to Deputy Chief John Cardona of the East Chicago Police Department. Cardona had been a member of a Spanish-speaking political club that was at odds with Jay Given. Several eyewitnesses placed Cardona at the Elks Club on the night of the shooting.
Mr. Cardona was very active in the Spanish organization. They were not welcome at this event. He gave two or three different reasons why he was there based on different conversations. He at some point in time acknowledged that he was there to watch Jay Given. Given had made it clear that if his people came in power in the city, there were going to be some changes, and Cardona was one of those changes. As a matter of fact, the comment that was used that if he got in, Cardona would be walking the beat.
No witnesses saw Cardona when Given headed towards the exit. But one person who was there says that shortly before the shooting, he saw Given talking to a man in the lobby. Investigators believe that man could have been John Cardona.
He described the man that was talking with Mr. Given as approximately 6'1", black, wavy hair, in a bluish-gray suit, consistent with what Mr. Cardona was wearing at the time and his size. He went into the washroom, and as he was in the washroom, he heard a gunshot. When he came out of the washroom immediately, he saw Mr. Given lying face down on the floor, and the other person was gone.
Cardona insists that he was in the Elks Club bar when Given was gunned down.
Witnesses who were seated at the bar who know him could not place him there. The only person that puts John in the bar at the time of the shooting is John himself.
You tell the investigators the truth about this case?
Yes.
Everyone in the police department, including Cardona, was asked to take a polygraph test. He failed the test, and when he refused to take a second exam, he was dismissed from the police department. Cardona later moved out of state. All the evidence seems to point to John Cardona as the killer. He fit the description of the man seen talking with Jay Given. He owned the Detonics handgun, although he claimed that it had been stolen. And finally, Cardona had access to the drawer where the evidence had been kept. But others questioned whether a case could be made that John Cardona was the killer. Cardona was well known and easily identified. Yet out of hundreds of potential witnesses at the fundraising event, not a single person had come forward to testify against him. Perhaps this is why prosecutors never filed charges against Cardona.
The local prosecutor could not afford to lose this case. He wanted basically a tight case, and he didn't think his case was tight enough.
Police believe there are witnesses who haven't come forward that may help crack this case. Just before the shooting, five people were coming down the stairway of the Elks Club. Three of them, all men, were near the foot of the steps at the very moment Jay Given was shot. Those three men have never been identified. The police hope that one of them saw the killer and will come forward with information.
I would like to see an indictment. I'd like to see a trial. And if John Cardona didn't do it, then fine. Let's put it to a jury. And if he didn't do it, in the eyes of the jury, beyond a reasonable doubt, there you have it. Let's go after whoever did do it. It's very frustrating to not have some closure on this.
Next, psychic communication from beyond the grave helps rediscover long-lost family connections. On a rainy afternoon, curiosity got the best of an 8-year-old boy named Hank Jones. His basement held a tempting mystery, an old steamer trunk filled with relics from the past.
I opened the lid, and inside was just a treasure trove of material on our family. I never knew any of my grandparents except my mother's mother. And in a sense, by seeing their pictures, by reading their diaries, by looking at their letters, they came alive to me. And ever since that time, I've been climbing the family tree, trying to find out as much as I could about my ancestry.
When Hank first looked into that trunk, he had no idea he had just set the course for the rest of his life. Hank Jones is now a genealogist. His job is digging through other people's old trunks and dusty relics, trying to piece together their family histories. Hank and other genealogists claim that during their research, they are sometimes guided by mysterious forces, perhaps the spirits of those who are long dead and long forgotten. Tracking down his own ancestors has been one of Hank's greatest challenges. He is descendant from the Palatines, a group of emigrants from southern Germany. During his research, Hank found himself especially intrigued by one man. Johann Dietrich Schneider belonged to a group of 847 Palatine families who had left Germany for New York.
I don't know why, but I felt this almost obsession to find out more about them. So I hired a lady named Carla Mittelstedt Kubitschek to go village to village for me, looking for all these families in Germany. And so just off the top of my head, I said, Carla, I have no vested interest in any of them, but I've always been interested in a man named Dietrich Schneider who came in this group to New York from Germany. Go look for him first.
Hank was stunned when he found out that he had picked the one person out of the entire migration who was actually related to him.
It was just the beginning of a bunch of strange coincidences, strange occurrences that started happening to me as I was studying these Palatine Germans. I would start to dream about particular home villages of certain immigrants I was looking for, but I hadn't found yet. So I decided to write down some of the places where the dream suggested I look. And lo and behold, we found about 5 to 7 of those families exactly where the dreams said they would be located overseas.
Hank became convinced that the spirits of his long-dead ancestors were leading him to places he would never have thought to investigate. He sent out letters to other genealogists to see if anyone else had a similar experience.
Well, I got 200 responses, and practically every response started with, I know what you mean, or yes, you've struck a familiar chord.
One of the most intriguing responses came from Dr. David Fox, a forensic psychologist in Ontario, Canada. In studying his bloodlines, David became fascinated by his great-great-grandfather, Charles Fox. David learned that Charles had been a sergeant in the British Army in the mid-1800s during the colonial campaigns in India and Pakistan. He had no idea what his great-great-grandfather looked like until he began having a strange, recurring vision.
I pictured him in his military uniform, his red coat, the buttons, and perhaps medals. And then the picture over time started to include his wife and his child, who would be my great-grandfather. And I thought, well, this is very strange because the probability of such a picture existing is so remote, so infinitesimal, you might as well say zero probability.
David traveled to England to search for more information about his ancestors. He stopped at the Norwich Castle, a museum and art gallery in Charles Fox's hometown.
Just as I was entering the doorway to one room, I noticed ahead of me was a very, very large portrait that just stood out almost three-dimensional. I was awestruck. It was like the little hairs on the nape of my neck were just standing up. I had pictured an item very similar to this, and there it was, right before my eyes.
David says the painting was the same family portrait he had seen in his vision.
The painting was completed by one Frederick Sandys in the year 1860. My great-grandfather would have been three in 1860. The woman in the picture was very much younger than the older soldier, and I knew that Sergeant Charles Fox's wife was 13 years his junior.
Could the man in the portrait really be David's ancestor? Three medals pictured on the uniform provided David with a clue. He learned that the medals in the painting had been awarded for the Sutlej campaign, the Punjab campaign, and for long service and good conduct. Those same three medals had been awarded to David's great-great-grandfather, Sergeant Charles Fox.
It's almost as if my head became fuzzy at that time. I had an image, the image in mind, that was translated into something there, something three-dimensional. To have the fantasy and reality merge in this way, I thought, this is quite incredible.
The best thing about it is that you have a feeling that your ancestors care about you, that they really want to be found. It's a sense of reuniting.
Carol Montrose would agree. While researching her family tree, Carol became intrigued with a woman named Catherine Reddish Stegmeyer, who she believed might be her great-great-aunt. But Carol was unable to find the date of Catherine's death or her gravesite. One day, Carol and her son were searching through cemeteries when they noticed a hot air balloon leaving the ground. They were 150 miles from home.
Can you follow me?
Sure.
So all of a sudden, there was a road on my right, and I turned, and we're sort of following the balloon at this point. And it came down so low that it actually clipped the top of the trees. And all of a sudden, I saw this church with a cemetery, and the balloon appeared to be landing in the back behind the church.
But instead of landing, the balloon took off again.
I'll be right back.
I thought that it wouldn't hurt to check the cemetery, even though I had never really considered any of the family having been buried there. Almost in the front row was Frederick Stegmeyer, a child of Kate. And I was ecstatic. I knew that I was at least in the right area.
There in the back row was the grave that she had been looking for. Carol likes to think that she found a grave because she followed the balloon. And she followed the balloon because her great-great-aunt guided her there.
It was so amazing, so strange. I can't say for sure Kate was trying to help me, but I sure feel like she was.
I believe it's very possible that the spirits of our ancestors in some way are directing us in our searches. They want to be found.
Can mysterious psychic forces really reach from beyond the grave and guide us to our long-lost ancestors? Well, for researchers like Hank, David, and Carol, the answer is a definite yes. Next, perhaps you can help locate the rightful heirs to a century-old Bible. On a previous broadcast, we featured a story that began in Madisonville, Tennessee, during the Great Depression. Tom Underwood was an out-of-work single father. He left his two young daughters, Madeline and Ada, in the care of a farmer, Charlie Best, and his family.
Times were hard, but he was willing to take them and give them a home and give them what we had to eat. It might not have been everything, but we never did go hungry.
Charlie treated the girls just like they were his own children. Over the next 2 years, Tom Underwood visited his daughters several times. But one day, Tom came for more than a visit.
Ian? Mr. Underwood.
Zella, may I come for the children? It's coming on nightfall, and I need to be on the road before dark.
Just like that, the girls were gone. Charlie Best and his family never again saw Madeline or Ada. At the time we filmed this story, Charlie Best was 96 years old. Although more than a half a century had gone by, he often mentioned the girls and wondered about their lives. Update. The night we aired this story, Ada Underwood was watching and recognized herself and her older sister, Madeline, who had passed away several years earlier. Ada traveled to Madisonville, Tennessee for a reunion with Charlie Best and his two children, Zella Mae and Carl.
Well, I was anxious to see her. It was exciting to know she was coming.
Well, you still look like yourself.
No, I'm a lot older.
Glad you got to come.
It's a day I have been waiting for really for 51 years.
I was very excited when I heard that they were looking for me because somebody cared enough about me to hunt for me that long.
Ada was only 8 years old when she last saw Charlie, but she never forgot his warmth and generosity.
You're right. Well, this year's Ada, Daddy, do you remember?
Charlie had to be very good to my sister and I for him to take us in and take care of us when we had nobody else to take care of us. And so I think he had to be a really great man.
He's pretty.
Thank you.
He's pretty.
It just meant a lot to Daddy, and I feel that in his own mind, dream has come true.
8 weeks after we filmed this update, Charlie Best passed away. According to his family, the reunion with Ada brought him great comfort in his final days. Indeed, Charlie's dream had come true. In Los Angeles, antiques collector Jonathan Grady was out browsing when he came across a box of forgotten treasures.
Excuse me, so how much for your Bunsen burners?
Well, let me see. I'll tell you what, I'll give you the whole box for $70.
After buying the box, I noticed there were several other things in the box that I could use. Some oil cans there and old scrub brushes, and there was this Bible. It's a very large Bible, very old. And the binding was torn, but yet it was part of the purchase price, so I took it home.
The Bible was more than a century old, its binding broken, its pages loose.
I thought something like this would be nice to display in my living room, but I had to have it repaired. And after checking with several bookstores in the area, I was told it would cost between $200 and $300. So I put it into the garage and I stored it away.
The Bible sat forgotten in Jonathan's garage, gathering dust and guarding its memories. Flash forward 10 years. Jonathan had started a writing career. One day, he needed a quote from the book of Job. He remembered the Bible that he had tucked away. As he looked through it, he came across a presentation page which he hadn't noticed before.
Everything stopped right there. I was completely surprised. I never found a character of Job. Instead, I found Lazarus.
The Bible had apparently been given to a Mr. Charles Lazarus and his bride, Fanny Bergman, on their wedding day, March 25th, 1874. They were married in Cincinnati, Ohio. When Jonathan turned the page, he found the history of an entire family. Charles and Fanny Lazarus had recorded the birth of two sons, Joshua and Samuel, and three daughters, Bluma, May, and Raina. On the facing page, Charles and Fanny recorded the birth of one grandchild, Bluma's daughter, Helen May Michelson. She was born in Denver, Colorado, on May 2nd, 1895.
I looked at this Bible for several days after that. I would refer to this page back and forth. I watched his kids grow. Some unknown source pulled me into this man's life, and I have not quit. I have not quit trying to locate another man's family.
This is Jonathan Grady in Los Angeles. I'm calling you regarding the Lazarus Family Bible.
Jonathan had become obsessed with returning the heirloom to its rightful owners.
There are family members. There were four siblings, living siblings of this man, all married. There has to be a granddaughter, a great-granddaughter. There's a relative there, I know.
The original owner of the Bible, Charles Lazarus, died on the 4th of July, 1913, and was buried at Mount Carmel Cemetery in New York. Any direct descendant of Charles and his wife, Fanny, would have a legitimate claim to the family Bible.